And lo and behold, our next guest, Senator Judd Gregg, is proposing a major step forward for a flatter and lower tax rate system. Whoa, 15, 25, and 35, if I have it right, for the personal marginal rates, 24% for the business tax rates. It's pro-growth. Finally, the Republicans may be listening to the Tea Partiers. A little bit of Reaganism from Judd Gregg. And there he is. Let's go to the aforementioned Senator Gregg. The right. Flinty-eyed Republican from New Hampshire, the ranking member on the Senate Budget Committee. Mr. Gregg, congratulations. Thank you for coming back on.
Well, I love to hear all this optimism, too, Larry.
I'm doing my best, sir.
Thank you.
Listen, Senator Gregg, let me just go. I want to go to this Jim Bunning story.
Yeah.
I'm defending him. Okay? I mean, actually, he's not filibustering. He just said no unanimous consent. You want to raise spending some more? Go ahead and vote on it. He just passed pay-as-you-go down there. Now it looks like Congress wants to violate it. What's your take on this Bunning business?
Well, he was asking the Senate to live by its own rules, and especially the Democrats, who made such a grandstanding event about a paygo about 3 weeks ago when they passed it and said they were going to subject all the new spending to paygo rules, and then immediately, the next day, they actually waived paygo for a highway bill. This is the second bill they will have waived paygo on. I think Jim's point is very valid. What they did, however, what the Democratic leadership did was they pushed it right up against the deadline so that essentially they created a situation where if you asked them to enforce their own rules on paygo and actually pay for it, then you would put it in a position where the benefit structure would be suspended because you couldn't reach the deadline. So they created this situation, and now they're blaming Jim for having asked them to live by their own rules. You know, I really think it's ironic. It's been reported very aggressively in the press in a negative way towards Jim, but I think he's trying to do what he thinks is right, and I respect him for trying to do that.
Well, bravo for you for saying bravo for Jim Bunning. I think it's all a great plan. I just want to come back to this. You yourself are a strong budget hawk, and this pay-as-you-go thing has been abused for so long, and here they put it back in again so the Congress can say they're being fiscally prudent, whatever that means anymore, and then they go ahead and break it. Now, as I understand it, Mr. Bunning is not even opposed to the unemployment extension, the compensation. He just wants it to be paid for. And as I understand it, you tell me, you're the expert, it's about $10 billion out of a $3.5 trillion budget. We can't find that? That's crazy, sir. That's why the public is in full revolt against Congress.
Well, you're absolutely right, of course. It's easy to find that type of money, especially when you've got a stimulus package, which is going to spend close to $400 billion after the recession is over in the years 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015. Let's just take, you know, $10 billion out of that ridiculous stimulus package that's going to be spent 3 or 4 years from now on walking around money for appropriators and put it towards paying this. Because what you're doing when you don't pay for this is you're taking a bill that's basically an ordinary expense, an expense which we're going to incur today, and you're giving it to our grandchildren. Why should our grandchildren pay for unemployment insurance today? Now, sure, we should extend these unemployment benefits because this is a very serious recession, but it should be paid for.
All right, great stuff. Let me move on. We got two other key topics. Number one, you and Mr. Ron Wyden have a, I'm going to call it a flat tax proposal. It's a flatter low tax rate. 15, 25, and 35% for individuals and 24% for businesses, which I think is just fabulous. Tell me about it. Tell me what you all are going to do about it. Tell me if it's going anyplace.
Well, it took us a couple of years to get this together. We really worked hard on it, and there are two different approaches here. I mean, Ron's a Democrat, I'm a Republican, and we basically have different philosophical views, but we both understood that our economy is suffering from the fact that we have a tax burden that has no relationship to capital productivity. And we are investing in and people are investing not for the purposes of creating better returns on their investment, but for the purposes of avoiding taxes. We felt very strongly, and I especially felt very strongly, but Ron did too, that if we could get the corporate tax rate down to a competitive rate with the rest of the industrialized world, we would make America an attractive place not only for American companies to create jobs, but for other companies to come from around the world and create jobs here too. And what we did was take the American tax rate, which is the second highest in the world at 35%, and move it down to 24%, which means we now will have a competitive advantage, should this pass, with all of our European neighbors and a large number of our Asian neighbors also. So we think that, I think this is extraordinarily positive for creating jobs here. This is a jobs bill by using the tax laws to have capital invested efficiently here in the United States.
Yeah, well, it seems like a lot of folks in Washington don't understand that you can't create a job without a healthy business, and a healthy business requires capital. An investment. I mean, that's
and risk takers.
That's a tautology, but I guess that's a hard thing to sell down there these days.
Yeah, well, you know, people just don't seem to understand that if you have an extra dollar and you're going to have to give 40% of that to the government, you're probably going to find somewhere to invest it where you only have to give maybe 15, 10% to the government, and that's tax avoidance, but it's legal. But it's an inefficient use of capital. What you want somebody to do is take that extra dollar and put it where they're going to get the best return, because if they get a good return, that's going to make us a more competitive economy. It's going to create more jobs, and in the end, it'll generate more revenues for the federal government.
I just want to make this statement that individuals who stand on principle, even these days, can make a difference. I think you, and I think Mr. Bunning, I think Mr. Kyle, who also supported Mr. Bunning, I think you've done a lot of good just in the last 24, 48 hours. And if the media in Washington doesn't take notice, sir, I think the voters will take notice and the American public will take notice.
Well, I hope you're right, Larry. I do think it's pretty obvious to most Americans that we're living so far beyond our means that we're going to be the first generation to pass on to our kids a country which is less prosperous and where they have a lower standard of living than we do, because we will be giving them so much debt. And it's not right for us to do these things, which basically involve day-to-day expenditures that benefit today's Americans, and take those bills and pass them on to tomorrow's Americans. It's not fair for one generation to do that to another generation. Nobody's opposed to the idea of making sure people who are on hard times get support. I strongly support that. But we should be willing to pay for it, and that's what Jim's point was.
Well, as long as I've known you these many years, you've said that. You have absolutely stood on that principle, and I think you get a lot of credit for it. Senator Gregg, I know you got work to do. We all got to move on. I want to ask you one last thing. At the top of the Drudge Report page, it says Obama to trigger nuke option on health care, in this case meaning reconciliation. I'm sure you know that this 51-vote majority for this massive, massive, what could be a takeover of 16 or 17% of the economy, going way beyond just a budget bill. This is very unpopular. Polls are showing the public is opposed to reconciliation and wants a 3/5 vote, just to make sure. Your thoughts on this reconciliation push for Obamacare?
Well, first you got to understand what it really means. They will actually have to pass the Senate bill first, which is the huge bill, the $2.5 trillion expansion of the federal government, the massive intrusion of the federal government into everybody's day-to-day lifestyle, especially through controlling health care. The bill that basically pushes a lot of people off their present insurance and forces them onto an exchange, which will inevitably lead to government-type programs. That bill will have to be passed first. And when they pass that bill, the president's got to sign it. So that means that bill will actually be the law before we get to the reconciliation bill. The reason they're doing this trailer bill or the reconciliation bill is to buy votes in the liberal caucuses in the House so that those folks will vote for the big bill. And so this is really serious. I mean, and the people should understand that that when that big bill passes, the president's got what he wants, and the American people are going to be getting the exact opposite of what they want, which is a massive intrusion of the government into their lifestyle. Whether the reconciliation bill passes or not, well, that's going to be problematic. I honestly think that House members who vote on the belief that they're going to get the reconciliation bill in the form that the House claims it's going to be in are really rolling the dice, because here in the Senate, reconciliation is one tough lift, and we're going to make it as hard as possible because it's really not an appropriate way to legislate on something this big.
Senator Gregg, this vote buying you referred to and this trailer bill, I mean, it seems to me, after what we saw with the Nebraska, what was it, the Cornhusker thing and the thing in Louisiana, the public went nuts over this.
This is going to make that look like small change.
Right.
Small change.
There's going to be a big turnover come November. That's what you're really saying. There's going to be a huge turnover.
What I'm saying is that this isn't the right way. They're railroading not only the Senate, but they're railroading the American people.
Senator Judd Gregg, it is such a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for your time, sir.